Let me welcome you here this evening. I'm Stan Altman, Dean of the School of Public Affairs. This is the second evening in our Public Affairs Week series. And this week, tonight's topic is civil liberties and national security. And there's probably no more important topic that has captured many of our attention since 9/11 happened. And I can't think of either a better panel or a more appropriate moderator than another member of our faculty, Sonia Jarvis, who is the Ackerman Chair this year, the Ackerman Chair on equality and justice in America, is to focus on exactly issues of tonight. And so I'm delighted to introduce tonight's moderator, Professor Sonia Jarvis.
Thank you, Dean Altman. To our speakers, faculty, students, and the public, it is my pleasure to welcome you to the second Public Affairs Week event sponsored by the School of Public Affairs here at Baruch. I will be the moderator for this session, and our focus tonight will be on the USA Patriot Act and its impact, both positive and negative, on our personal safety and individual rights. We are delighted to offer you two exceptional speakers on this topic of particular interest to the New York City community. Our first speaker will be Professor Amaitai Etzioni from George Washington University, who will address the topic of our plenary with reference to his most recent book on the USA Patriot Act. Copies are available on the table over here, How Patriotic is the Patriot Act? Graciously substituting for Laura Murphy of the ACLU, who was not able to join us tonight, is Matt Bowles from the ACLU's Washington Legislative Office, an office that's been at the forefront of efforts to constrain the overreach of the government's efforts to restrict personal liberties and freedoms in the wake of 9/11. In any ordered society, there's a natural tension between security and liberty. In his 1996 book, The New Golden Rule, Professor Etzioni reengages the age-old debate about what constitutes a good society. He argues that a good society requires a carefully maintained equilibrium of order and autonomy rather than the maximization of one or the other. Or put another way, he asks this question: can a society gain both more order and more liberty? Since the 1920s, the ACLU has championed the cause of vigilance over precious civil liberties as protected by the U.S. Constitution and its subsequent amendments. Its position on the USA Patriot Act has sought to educate the public on why some of the government's demands for new powers are both unnecessary and dangerous. One of the reasons I was interested in participating in tonight's session is because of my views on the USA Patriot Act. For any of my students that are here, I don't think it would come as any surprise that it's not my favorite piece of legislation. I'm particularly concerned that some of its provisions represent the greatest attack on personal liberty since the Japanese-American internments that followed in the wake of the attack on Pearl Harbor. Just this last week, we witnessed the death of Fred Korematsu, the Japanese-American who fought his internment unsuccessfully all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court in the infamous case of Korematsu versus the United States. And that case, among others, should remind us of the courage it takes to stand up for one's rights. A recent book by Professor Jeffrey Stone entitled Perilous Times, Free Speech in Wartime, From the Sedition Act of 1798 to the War on Terrorism, also serves to remind us that our pattern as a nation has been to restrict First Amendment rights during wartime. During this plenary, our speakers will present their views on how to balance the need to protect civil rights during a time of real and present danger as represented by terrorism. In terms of how we'll proceed, gentlemen, we will begin with Professor Etzioni, followed by Matt Bowles. I will then ask each of our speakers a few questions, and then we'll open it up to the full audience. And I will ask that you go to the microphone so that it will be part of the official record. Professor Etzioni, who received his PhD in sociology from the University of California, Berkeley, is also very familiar with New York City. He was a professor of sociology at Columbia University for 20 years, I think. Part of that time as chairman of the department. He was also a guest scholar at the Brookings Institution beginning in 1978 and then served as a senior advisor to President Carter's White House. He was also named the first university professor at George Washington University, where he is now the director of the Institute for Communitarian Policy Studies. From 1987 to 89, he served as the Thomas Henry Carroll Ford Foundation professor at the Harvard Business School. Professor Amaitai Etzioni has served as a president of the American Sociological Association and was the founding president of the International Society for the Advancement of Socioeconomics. In 1990, he founded the Communitarian Network, a not-for-profit, nonpartisan organization dedicated to shoring up the moral, social, and political foundations of society. He was the editor of the responsive community, Rights and Responsibilities, the organization's quarterly journal, from 1991 to 2004. And around 1991, the press began referring to him as the guru of the communitarian movement. Dr. Etzioni is the author of over 30 books, which I will not try to list today. A few of my favorites include The Limits of Privacy, a 1999 book, The New Golden Rule, which I quoted from a minute ago, which also received the Simon Wiesenthal Center's 1997 Tolerance Book Award, and the book he will discuss with us tonight, How Patriotic is the Patriot Act, Freedom versus Security in the Age of Terrorism. Professor Etzioni.
Dean Hoffman, Professor Jarvis, thank you for a very, very generous introduction and quoting from my favorite book. Above all, I appreciate it when you mentioned my service in the White House, that you made clear it was a Carter White House. And these days, especially when I go to Europe and somebody forgets to mention it, I'm lost before I started. Now, I'm happy we got this shackle out of the way, because what I have to tell you is not in any way amusing or funny. There is no expert, none, American, European, United Nations, Harvard, who studied recently the question, if we are going to face a nuclear attack by terrorists, who did not come to the same conclusion, that we're very likely to see a major city taken out by nuclear terrorism. It may not be Chicago, it may be New Delhi or Tel Aviv, but the consequences are beyond our grasp, beyond our imagination. There are 80 suitcase-sized nuclear weapons gone missing in Russia, a country which is known for being corrupt. They sell them under the table. There are piles and piles of plutonium and highly enriched uranium, which are poorly supervised. There are tactical nuclear weapons in Pakistan, and by the time this meeting is over, you may hear in the headlines that the Taliban took over the government because they keep trying to kill its president. China just built a new nuclear reactor in Nigeria. I don't want to go on and on. You go on Google and find those reports. But terrorism is not, do I have to tell New Yorkers, it's not to be taken lightly. In effect, one of the reasons is that for everyone we catch, we produce 10 in Iraq by the way we treat the population. The fact that now a few years pass since 9/11, should not lull you into complacency. It took al-Qaeda 8 years between the first attack on the World Trade Center and the second attack. And the second attack was 1,000 times more damaging by just the number of casualties than the first one. So if another 4 years will pass before the next attack will come, that is not an inordinate time for this challenge. Nobody disagrees that we have a major national security issue. I feel equally strongly and clearly that our rights, the Bill of Rights, our civil liberties, our individual rights, are what makes us American, what makes this fight worthwhile. And I agree with those who say, if you're going to cut our liberties in order to protect our security, we'll do the work of the terrorists for them. Because what they really want in the end is not just to kill us, they want to undermine and abolish our kind of form of government. That is what's most threatening to them, the notion of well-nurtured, cemented liberty and freedom. Therefore, ladies and gentlemen, the starting point of any serious conversation on the subject must be that we face two very serious demands. One is we must take measures to protect us from very serious threats, and we must treat our rights as sacred and find ways to protect them. And any conversation which takes only one of those claims and downgrades and try to diminish or disregard or make light of the other one is not worthy of serious discussion. And yes, as Professor Jarvis said, there is a tension between these two. The conversation starts with the fact that we face two compelling purposes which cannot be easily both served fully. But to start by disregarding one of them or making light of one of them, it just doesn't get us any place. The reason I say that, because we have a tradition in our courts. Anybody who see any television show, I think some of you may not have time for that, but you know, you used to when you were younger, I guess, knows the pattern we have in our courts, where each of the two sides it takes the most extreme possible advocacy position, and they lie, cheat, and make up B plans and everything they can to make the case for their side, completely disregarding the merit of the other side. And the idea is that out of clashes of two extreme advocacies, truth and justice will arise. I don't think it works very well in courts. One says this guy is the ultimate killer, and he raped and seduced and stole. Another one says he's a wonderful son and has a lovely... And out of this, supposed to write a correct image of the defendant. But in May, frankly, I don't think so, but it may work in courts. When this is transported in our discussion of public policy, and I understand some of you have a special interest in that, extreme advocacy is not a virtue and does not lead us to the right kind of public policies, which have to carefully weigh these two sets of consideration. The Constitution offers us guidance here. The Fourth Amendment is only one of two of our Bill of Rights which explicitly recognize the issue at hand. Unlike the Fourth Amendment, which is written in a much more absolute manner, which says Congress shall make no law, the Fourth Amendment says, and please listen to those critical words, there be no unreasonable search and seizure. There be no unreasonable. It doesn't say there be no search. And the line between reasonable and unreasonable directly speak to the fact that there is a category of reasonable search, that which is in the public interest, compelling public interest. And the Constitution begins to provide a mechanism for sorting out what's reasonable, what's unreasonable. And One of them is that you have to go to a judge. You have to prevent the data to the judge. They have a reason for the search. The data has to be compelling. We can argue about exactly what is sufficient. But the starting point from the Constitution, that what we talk about our rights is not that the ground or all the decisions go one way, but is recognized on the face of it that we face here a situation of balance. I'll come in a minute to grade the Patriot Act by this criteria. But I need to add one critical point, critical. We often look at specific new technologies, like, let's say, cameras in public spaces, or new listening devices, and we try to judge them by their own. Are these good or bad technologies? I'd like to suggest to you a different approach, that often the issue is not merely or even firstly the intrinsic nature of the technology, but how carefully and closely its use is supervised, held accountable for, not just by the government, but also by civilian review boards. Now, since such a crucial point, let me elaborate a little. To save time, and we are, I could go on for 2 weeks on this, listener. To save time, let me use a very, very simple example. When you go on a highways, we use the easy pass. The easy pass, I did talk about the other day at NPR in Wisconsin. Turns out Wisconsin doesn't have them. So if anybody's here from Wisconsin, they allow you to zoom through the toll booth without stopping because it recognizes that you paid ahead for the chip in there. And now, imagine two extreme situations. One situation in which immediately after you pass through the toll booth, and by the way, you don't have to. It's a voluntary act. You don't have to use the easy pass. If you don't want anybody to know about that you passed, you can just pay cash. You chose that deal. Immediately after you pass and it checks that you paid, it erases the information. That's one extreme. Let's take the opposite extreme. Same easy pass. After you pass, the government keeps this information for the next 10 years, makes it available to the press and divorce lawyers, and adds it to a very detailed dossier which Checkpoint keeps on everything you do in your private life, and that's available from then on to all commercial and government forces. Most of us would find the first arrangement quite tolerable and benign. All of us would be horrified by the opposite extreme, and then there are all those in between. So the issue here is not, are we for or against this new security device? But the question, how carefully is its use supervised and monitored? There are layers of supervision, accountability, and oversight built into the government. The Inspector General, in effect, even of the Department of Justice, issued a very scathing report on the way the FBI conducted itself. There are congressional committees whose job is at least supposed to be in the oversight business. But I don't, and the media, by the way, does play a role, despite the fact that there's a Murdoch and all that. I don't think these are sufficient. And what I strongly recommend, and we may be getting some of that, maybe, is an independent review board, somewhat like the citizen review board of the police. There'd be a board composed of privacy advocates, civil rights lawyers, some security experts, who will have clearance, who will regularly review the use of new security means to reassure us if it's true or warn us when it's not that these devices are properly used. And if we're going to have good and civilian-based accountability, then we can give a little more license to security than we would dare otherwise. Now about the Patriot Act itself. It has more than 150 clauses. Those of you who want to throw it out of the dirty dishes, should notice that there are more than 100 of those items which nobody contests, ACLU or anybody else. They're just 80% of the bill is not contested by anybody. It doesn't mean we shouldn't be terribly troubled by the other 20%, but before you just throw the whole thing out, there's something you should take into account. The other of the measures, and I'll illustrate at the moment, if you approach it with this Fourth Amendment view in mind, you see that the divide and separate system measures, some of them seem to me, and I'll try to document very quickly, very reasonable. Some are terribly troubling, and some are in between. To save time, I'll give one or two examples from each category. From the what I consider reasonable, and all of those are subject to deliberation. Before 9/11, we had a tradition that if you go to a court and you present sufficient evidence to a judge that somebody is a suspect of being a terrorist, you can get a permission to tap his phone. That permission, that warrant, was limited to that particular phone. Because in the olden days when that law was passed, most people had one phone, and you got to that phone line outside the house, and you just put a little tab on it, and you did your job. Since then, people got, maybe you noticed, cell phones and emails and all kind of other instruments. And the drug lord had a field day with it, because they had a pocket full of half a dozen cell phones, and they switched them around. And the FBI or police had to go each time to the court to get permission to tap one other phone. And the Patriot Act, something known as roving wiretaps, when you convince the court that you have a case, you're now allowed to follow the person disregarding what instrument he is using. That, in my judgment, is simply a case where the law caught up as a technology. It doesn't change the basic situation. You have to have compelling reason. You have to have a judge involved, and then you can pursue. Another example, the warrants used to be local, because the phone lines, even if you have the long distance, it was a local instrument. With the internet, we now have nation warrants, so you can intercept the internet with permission any place, not just in your little town. Seems to me unreasonable, sir. If you go to the other end, the notion that you can detain an American without bringing him before a judge, without allowing him access to a lawyer, for an indefinite amount of time, seems to me such a wholesale, gross, unnecessary violation of the Constitution that if it didn't have already curly gray hair, it would both curl and gray. Why would you not allow that person, after a reasonable period of time, take him before a judge, with security clearance, and explain why I need to hold him for another 30 days? Why would you take an American and strip her from all her rights? Or take the military tribunals, which technically are not part of the Patriot Act, but they're part of the same attitude. The way they were originally drafted, you could not appeal even to a higher military court. You couldn't have a lawyer, and the rules were secret. I mean, this is worse than the Soviet Union. So my urge on you, if you keep in mind where we started, that we have two considerations here. We do need to worry about security, and we must cherish our rights, that you don't treat all the items of the Patriot Act as if they were one kind, that you assess them one at a time, and you see that some of them are very troubling, and some of them seem to me at least quite reasonable. Before I close on another point, let me tell you about one which I find particularly difficult. And I must admit that on, what is today? Monday? Tuesday. Okay, I'm on Tuesdays and Thursdays, I'm very upset about it. And on Mondays and Wednesdays, I'm a little more relaxed about it. And that is, after 9/11, there's been a major shift in the strategy of law enforcement. Before 9/11, the idea was that if somebody commits a crime, you collect evidence, and if there's enough evidence, you take them to court. But the idea was, basically, you catch them after they commit the crime, because you're not going to go somebody who didn't do anything yet. With terrorists who drive their airplanes into buildings and commit suicide or car bombs and such, there's no way to deter them if you're going to go to them after them after they committed suicide. I mean, it makes no sense to try to collect evidence that they commit the crime after they drove into the World Trade Center. So the new law enforcement strategy is to engage in prevention rather than prosecution. Tragically, prevention by definition means hassling innocent people. Because prevention means you talk to people who didn't do anything yet. In the effort to try to chill, that's what the purpose is, to ferret out, unsettle some sleeper cell which may be somewhere in there. Let me make it a little less abstract. The FBI invited 5,000 Iraqi Americans to come to the headquarters in Detroit for an interview. There was no claim that any of them did anything wrong. And believe you me, if you didn't have this experience, being asked to just come down for a little interview at the FBI on Wednesday afternoon is not something which most of us would take very lightly, especially if there's a hint, if you don't come, we'll pick you up anyhow. And so that's a fairly a brutal measure. But the other side says, without some such shaking of the tree, we will not be able to discombobulate the terrorists. We will not be able to ferret out things which are happening there. And by the way, it gets very close to the issue you raised, taking an ethnic group, you know, not all of it, but a subgroup, a male of certain age, certain group, and saying, I'm calling you in not because you're a suspect, but because of a certain background you have. And I want you to stay with this issue for a moment, just in all seriousness. Think for a moment that you have a magic lever, and if you pull it, all these activities will cease. Nobody will go and prod anything anymore until there is evidence that a crime is being committed. And how much confidence aid is going to give to the terrorist. Or for a moment, feel into the shoes of the person who didn't do anything and is invited to come to the FBI headquarters. So at least you see the dilemma, the challenge we are facing in sorting out various parts of the Patriot Act. And let me close on the last point, and that's, I think, in some ways the most important one, and is documented in great detail in the book, which I cannot give all the data now. The question is, how does a nation lose its liberty? I mean, other than not through occupation. But a very common scenario is that you take away a little liberty, a little right, and then nobody says squawks, and then you take out a little more, and then a little more, kind of salami tactics, or slippery slope, and pretty soon nothing is left. By the way, that's the way it says on the Holocaust Museum. Never happened that way. Liberty is lost when you do not provide sufficient security. On September 12th, 70% of Americans said, forget about the Bill of Rights, give me security. Not that surprising. Britain suspended its constitution, basically, when it faced the Nazis about to invade it. When people panic, when people are attacked, security is in their mind and they're willing to forgo the Bill of Rights. My data shows very, very clearly with every month that passed, as people became less panicky, as they return to flying, which is a very interesting measurement of how secure they feel, they became more demanding that our rights would be cherished. And now the return to flying is completely and exceeds, in effect, the flying level before 9/11. Now 70% of Americans say, be sure to protect my rights. Let's think about security later. That's one very clear evidence, very strong correlation for those of you who follow that language, between how panicky people are and how much they're willing to line up for their rights. And believe me, if somebody takes out an American city, the people will not line up the next day asking for the finer points of the Constitution. Some of you were old enough to live in this city as I did when the crime rate was very high. In those days, the police chief in Los Angeles said, shoot first, ask questions later. He was considered a great hero. Today, he wouldn't last the afternoon. Why? Because in the days we were told as New Yorkers, don't walk at dark, don't go into the park, go only in groups, you know, tell your mother before you're leaving. In those days, people were willing. They were so panicky, so terrorized, that they're willing to support strong regimes. If you look what's happening now in Russia, where antisocial behavior is momentous, you see why the Russians are voting for a strong armed leader. We want democracy, we want security, we need to be sure to nurture both. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Etzioni. You're getting us off to a great start, and I'd like to now introduce our second speaker, Matt Bowles, the National Field Organizer for the American Civil Liberties Union Washington Legislative Office. As a member of the ACLU's Keep America Safe and Free campaign, Bowles mobilizes civil liberties activists nationwide to defend their local communities from government abuse and to pressure Congress to roll back repressive post-9/11 policies. As a national organizer, he travels around the country to educate people about the USA Patriot Act and other governmental actions taken since 9/11 that undermine personal freedom and liberty. He's worked with diverse communities around the country. He's worked to build grassroots coalitions in opposition to abusive policies such as racial profiling, targeting of immigrants, intrusive surveillance, and the repression of political activism. Part of that effort has been to encourage local governments to pass resolutions that refuse to allow local resources and institutions to be used to support the Patriot Act. Before joining the ACLU, Bowles worked as a labor organizer with the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees Union, and as the Issues Advocacy Director for the Irish American Unity Conference. He has also served on the National Board of the Consortium on Peace, Research, Education, and Development, where he helped organize alternative education trips and international observer delegations to the north of Ireland. He has done extensive Palestinian solidarity work and solidarity work with the Zapatista movement in indigenous communities in Mexico. He has also been active in the movement against corporate globalization and the movement against the U.S. invasions of Afghanistan and Iraq. He's also worked in, I think, a number of coalitions involving the death penalty and against racism generally within the criminal justice system. He holds a bachelor's degree in sociology from the John Carroll University and a master's degree in international peace and conflict resolution from American University in Washington. Please join me in welcoming a crusader for social justice to the School of Public Affairs.
What's up, Baruch? Thank you so much for having me here tonight. It is an honor to be here, and I really want to thank the university for setting up a discussion tonight on such an important topic. This is something that every single person in this room has a stake in. It affects each one of us, and together we can do something about it if we choose to. I'd like to start off with a quick survey. How many people in this room use email? How many people have used the library here at Baruch? That's pretty good. Anybody have a bank account? A couple people. Right. So right now, the FBI could have already seized your personal records about what books you take out of the library, your financial records, your medical records, and you wouldn't know about it. That should be the first red flag. A government that operates in secret and a government that can seize information on people that are not suspected of doing anything wrong at all. That is a provision of the USA Patriot Act. The government has put a gag order on that provision so that the librarian or the banker or the doctor who turns over your records is not allowed to tell you that they gave those records over under possible penalty of jail time. A government of the people, by the people, and for the people probably ought be accountable to the people. And when the government is not, when the government operates in secret, we enter a very dangerous situation. Welcome to post 9/11 America. The concept of our democracy and the relation of between citizen and government has been fundamentally altered. There has been a radical concentration of power into the executive branch and a systematic dismantling of checks on that power by the judiciary. Our government can now search your college dorm room, or your house, or your office, download things off the computer, look through your files, remove your personal property and leave, and not tell you about it for years. You might come home and thought you were robbed, but no, it was just the government. This is post 9/11 America, and it's a very dangerous place because the government now has extraordinary power to act as it feels appropriate without constraint. And that's dangerous because this is a government that feels it's appropriate to rummage through your personal information of American citizens without first having to suspect you of a crime. This is a government that feels it's appropriate to target people based on their race, ethnicity, religion, or country of origin instead of on their intent to commit a crime. This is a government that feels it's appropriate to spy on political and religious activity without even a tip that there is any wrongdoing going on there whatsoever. This is a government that feels it's appropriate to dispense with international law and proceed to torture people, beat them, and sick dogs on them. This is a government that is out of control. And it's up to us, the people, to rein in the government, to restore checks and balances, to restore transparency, to restore accountability, and to take back our democracy. These are issues that affect all of us here and that are going to affect our kids even more. We need to decide what kind of society we want to live in and then work together to build it. And this discussion could not be more timely because this year, the Patriot Act sunset provisions, which is the 10% of the Patriot Act that was so controversial that Congress made it temporary, that part of the Patriot Act is set to expire this year. And in fact, today in Congress, the Senate hearings began on the Patriot Act and the sunset provisions. Tomorrow, another bill is going to be reintroduced that was introduced last year called the SAFE Act, Security and Freedom Insured, which would help to bring other parts of the Patriot Act back in line with the Constitution. So we have vehicles to fix the Patriot Act. And it's a question of how well we can mobilize and organize and pressure our representatives to do the right thing. There's a few broad themes that I want to draw out that we see in the post 9/11. There's a giant panoply of policies, by the way. This is important. I mean, this goes way beyond the Patriot Act. The Patriot Act is perhaps the most visible and iconic of the post 9/11 policies. But to be honest with you, it's probably responsible for no more than 20% of the abuses post 9/11. 80 to 90% of the abuses have been under other policies, and it's important to include those when we discuss this and not just limit it to the Patriot Act. In terms of the themes that we've seen post 9/11, there's been an orchestrated campaign of racial targeting designed to repress and incarcerate communities of color and immigrants. We've seen the onset of a surveillance society and an extraordinary increase in the government's ability to spy on law-abiding citizens. And finally, we've seen the definition of terrorism expanded so broadly that it allows the government, potentially, to charge people engaged in nonviolent political dissent and prosecute them as terrorists. I also want to break down the dominant discourses a little bit tonight that are used by the government and by the media and by many academics to justify these policies. And I want to talk about how efficient these policies are. Are we actually being kept safe, or are we just told we're being kept safe? That's a very important distinction to make. And finally, I want to talk about what we can do. Because sometimes these issues are so large and they're so overwhelming that it becomes almost inconceivable that we as an individual person or as a small group of people could make a change. And so I want to talk about some very specific things that we can do to affect these policies. So let's start with racial profiling. Most white people would think it absurd to begin detaining white Christian U.S. military veterans. Am I right? But that was the profile of the man who committed the second largest bombing on U.S. soil in American history. Now, the reason why we would consider it absurd to begin interrogating, detaining, and so forth, white Christians, is because it would be outrageously ineffective. I mean, that's pretty much the reason. Now, unless we're racist, it should be equally obvious that detaining Arabs and Muslims and interviewing them for no apparent reason will be equally as ineffective. Why would a Muslim be more inclined to know something about Osama bin Laden than I would be inclined to know something about Timothy McVeigh? That's obvious if we're not racist. But through the lens of the media and the discourse and everything that we're inundated with and all of the fear-mongering propaganda, some of this stuff almost starts to make sense in a haze if we don't really stop and think about it. So let's look at how effective these policies have been. Since 9/11, thousands of people, we don't know exactly how many because they stopped counting at 1,200, have been rounded up. See, what Ashcroft started doing was he wanted to ensure people the government was doing something, right? So he said, oh, we've got, you know, 50 people in jail. We've got 100 people in jail. We've got 500 people in jail. We've got 1,200 people in jail. Then reporters started asking, oh, yeah, well, how many of those people did you connect to 9/11? Zero. And at that point, they stopped counting, but they still detained people. Because at that point, it began to look negative on them if they couldn't connect these people with 9/11. The estimate, I think a conservative estimate, would be that at least 5,000 people of Arab, Muslim, and South Asian descent have been detained since 9/11. A few years into this now, after they've had a chance to sort through all those people, you know how many of them have been charged with terrorism? Anybody know? Zero. Not one. Now, that result would be predictable if we applied the same non-racist standard that we applied to white Christians after the Oklahoma City bombing, but we didn't do that. Now, then there was the call-in registration program, right, where men from Muslim countries had to come in and register with the government. You know, we had 17 Muslim countries, and then North Korea for good measure, because we wouldn't want anyone to think we were racially profiling or anything, so we kind of threw them in, you know. And we registered 83,310 people. And of those people, we ended up deporting 13,740 people. That's quite a lot. Anybody know, out of that giant number, how many of those people were charged with terrorism? Zero, not one. And by the way, that was also the same department conducting that sent Mohammed Atta his visa 6 months after September 11th, right? So if we wanted to do something, maybe we should start by thinking about how we can make the institutions we already have a little bit more efficient, a little bit more effective, a little bit less bureaucratic, and try to improve the internal functioning of our intelligence agencies instead of just increasing the power and putting on policies of racial profiling. Since 9/11, the government has declared a war on terrorism. What they have waged is a war on immigrants. They've waged a war on the Arab, Muslim, and South Asian people. They've waged a war on communities of color. They've waged a war on the very Bill of Rights that is designed to protect us from government abuse. They have sold us a sham. They have exploited our desire to be safe, and they've sold us policies that forward a racist agenda without making us safe. In fact, these policies make us less safe. Enormous amounts of law enforcement resources, not to mention millions of dollars, have been put into these massive racial profiling dragnets that have not yielded one convicted terrorist. That makes us less safe, because tying up our law enforcement resources in outrageously ineffective racial profiling dragnets takes those law enforcement resources away from doing things like following clues, investigating people that might actually be involved with a criminal act. These policies make us less safe. And that's just one example, but that's just the beginning. Did anybody here see Michael Moore's film Fahrenheit 9/11? Right. So you remember in that film, he documents this one example of the new FBI spying powers, where there's this pacifist group in Fresno, California called Peace Fresno, and they kind of meet, you know, weekly and stuff. And there was this guy who came, was coming to the meeting every week, you know, regularly taking notes and all that kind of stuff. And then one day the guy happened to die in a car accident. And when they looked at his obituary in the paper, it had the picture of the guy that they knew, but it had a different name. And then they said, wait a minute, that can't be right. And then they continued to read on, and it said that this person was working for the FBI Joint Terrorism Task Force, infiltrating pacifist peace groups. Now, the reason we know about that is because the guy died. If he did not die, then we would not know, and that guy would probably still be in the meeting every single week attending it, pretending to be a member. Right? Because all of this stuff is conducted in secret, we have no way of knowing how many pacifist peace groups and similar organizations are being infiltrated at this time. But we know of that, and we know of others that have been exposed for various reasons. The FBI can now do this. How many people here have heard of COINTELPRO? Not quite as many. COINTELPRO, and I would encourage you, I would highly encourage you to look up COINTELPRO. It stands for Counterintelligence Program. And this was J. Edgar Hoover's programs that he was running when he ran the FBI, which was infiltrating all sorts of political dissident groups and sabotaging them and committing all sorts of pretty remarkable acts. I would encourage you to take a look at it. And this is, we're ranging from the Black Panthers to Martin Luther King here, okay? Now, when COINTELPRO got exposed for what it was, and this was everything from disseminating false propaganda on groups, infiltrating groups, training groups to commit violence, all the way up until murder. The Black Panther leader, Fred Hampton, was actually murdered in an operation that involved the COINTELPRO program. And when it got exposed about how extraordinary these FBI actions were, there was a set of FBI guidelines that were put in place to make sure that that could not happen again. And those guidelines were in place all the way up until John Ashcroft rewrote them. And now we're pretty much right back where the FBI does not even have to be following a lead, let alone have individualized suspicion or probable cause. Don't even have to be following a lead to spy on a public political meeting, religious ceremony, and so on. That's pretty dangerous. But let's say that you're not even a political activist. Let's say you're a normal graduate student and you want to go to Las Vegas for a New Year's Eve celebration to go party and get out of the city. Well, in 2004, about 270,000 people went to Las Vegas for a New Year's Eve celebration, kind of like the one they have here in New York. Not quite as many, but. And the government, the FBI, decided to try out its Patriot Act powers. They used Section 505, which is a national security letter power, which is quite extraordinary because the government does not need to get any approval from any judge whatsoever to use this power. They can issue a letter directly from the executive branch and seize records of all sorts. Not any kind of record, but a lot of records, including financial records, including casino guest lists, as they did on New Year's Eve. So they swept in. They went to every single hotel and casino and got the names of every single person staying there. They got the names of everybody that flew into the airport in the 2 weeks around New Year's Eve. They got the name of everybody that rented a car or truck in Las Vegas in the 2 weeks around New Year's Eve. Who knows what they're doing with that information? A Washington Post ran a front page story saying they didn't even have any suspicion that there was going to be a terrorist attack in Las Vegas. They had no credible evidence whatsoever. But they got all this information. And when a casino gives information, they're not able to just disaggregate the name from all the rest of the information that they keep on you, which is a lot of stuff for some people, what clubs you like to go to, what you like to do in Las Vegas. You seen that commercial, What Happens in Vegas Stays in Vegas? This time what happened in Vegas got tracked, monitored, and sent to the FBI. And I'll tell you what J. Edgar Hoover used to do. He used to spy on people, get personal information about them, and then use it for political blackmail. So I think this should be really particularly alarming. And so what's the discourse that they've been using to justify all of these types of extraordinary policies? They've been playing on two things. One is fear, and two is racism. I mean, that's really what it boils down to. They have gone to extraordinary lengths to indoctrinate us with fear, and fear of to tell us that we need these security policies. And what have they told us? Remember when they jacked the security alert up to code orange or pink or red or whatever it was, and they told us we need to go buy duct tape? Remember that? Everybody's laughing about it now, but when that was happening, people were going out to the store to buy duct tape because we weren't exactly rationally considering what we were getting, right? We just went and did what they told us, right? What happened after 9/11? You got Rudy Giuliani on your TV or George W. Bush on your TV or someone else like that, and you turn it on, and that's all it is, telling you, you have to do this. You have to accept this security policy, and you have to accept the civil liberties trade-off. There's nothing to do, nothing else you can do. You have no other choice. You have to take it, right? Now, it should arouse suspicion when the government is telling us that we have to accept a security trade-off and that we have to surrender our civil liberties, because the government doesn't have to pay any of the cost. It's only us that has to pay the cost. The government benefits. When the person benefiting is telling you what to do, you have to ask a question, right? I mean, and we need to think about that, about the agenda, about where this is coming from, right? When you fly on an airplane, right? Do you remember this? I mean, I remember this. I was flying an airplane, right? They confiscated my, you know, tweezers and my nail clippers and my nail file. Who am I going to hurt with my nail file? I don't know, right? But you know what they didn't confiscate? They didn't confiscate cigarettes and matches. That's actual combustible material. You know, anybody know why they didn't confiscate cigarettes and matches? Ask who benefits, right? When these thousands of smokers fly, right? They get off the plane. You can't smoke on a plane. First thing you want to do, light up a cigarette. If nobody can light up a cigarette when they get off the plane, who loses? Tobacco industry loses. The tobacco lobby got involved in lobbying Congress about the list of things prohibited on the airplane, and they allowed people to take cigarettes and matches on the plane. If the tweezer lobby had been a little bit more powerful, maybe they could have gotten their way, but no. The point is that a lot of this stuff that they've been selling us doesn't necessarily keep us safe, okay? They tell us it does, right? And they tell us we have to accept and some of it's just absurd, like go buy duct tape and don't bring tweezers, but some of it's serious stuff. Some of it's stuff that seriously diminishes our Constitution, our Bill of Rights, our society. They tell us we have to accept this, right? So when white people tell you that you have to accept these policies of racial profiling, we should question that. When the government tells you you have to give us more power and give up your right to keep us in line, we should ask questions about that. So we always, I think, need to consider the agenda. We always need to consider whether or not these policies actually keep us safe. And then we also need to consider, if we give this up, how are we going to get it back, right? And a lot of times, you can't get it back. At this point, I want to conclude by just saying what we can try to do to take some of this stuff back. Historically, when the government oversteps its bounds, when we get into a situation where the government is enacting a policy that is abusive, that is oppressive, whether it's anything from slavery to segregation to the denial of civil rights, the denial of women's rights, the denial of gay rights, whatever it may be, it has been grassroots social movements organized by the people at a local level, starting in university forums like this, that have been able to push back the government and to change those policies. I would encourage you this evening to think about that and to think about what we, what people, what students right here at Baruch College can do to participate in the movement to take back our civil liberties. Communities, this very weekend, in fact, Saturday, the state of Montana, after a large organizing drive by people there, yes, way out west in Montana, most people probably never been there, probably don't know anybody there. I hadn't been there till this year. But activists out in the state of Montana have been organizing and organizing and organizing. And this Saturday, the state legislature of Montana passed a policy that says no agency or instrumentality of our state will participate in these Patriot Act abuses. If you come here and you tell us you want us to help you find all the Muslims so that you can interrogate them without suspecting them of any wrongdoing, we're going to say, I'm sorry, that's racial profiling. We don't do that here. No agency of the state of Montana will enforce federal immigration law. They will not spy on First Amendment activity. They will not participate in any of these abuses. And furthermore, they've instructed their libraries to destroy records, so that if anybody comes for the library records, there'll be none there to give. All of these things that Montana did have been done by other communities across the country, hundreds of communities across the country. New York City, in fact, passed the resolution, and colleges can pass them too. You have a library, you have a police force. Students here are being targeted as well. So I want to conclude with that and wrap it up and say that I look very much forward to participating in the discussions with students after this, because I'm sure many of you have had experiences, perhaps personal experiences, with these policies that I haven't, and I would love to hear about them. Thank you for having me.